Hachette Audio presents Government Zero. No borders, no language, no culture. Written by Michael Savage. Read by Barry Baer. Chapter 1. Government Zero. What is Government Zero? There is a dance of death in the West, and actual death in the Middle East, courtesy of the Islamo-fascists. Meanwhile, the Caesar in the White House entertains himself with 1,000 sycophants, partying on behind closed doors as if the Islamo-fascist hand will not touch him. He thinks he's protected from this new plague, the Black Death of radical Islam. We're facing something the West hasn't had to deal with since the wars of religion in the 16th and 17th centuries. When those religious wars ended in one place, they began in another. They lasted for over 100 years. The same thing is happening right now. The radical Muslims are on the warpath, and they are against everyone else. They are against Muslims who are not as fanatical. They are against the members of all other religions. They think they are going to take us back to some pristine religious period in human history that never actually occurred. It's all complete rubbish. These faith warriors live lower than the pigs they despise. They kidnap and rape 8-year-old girls and say the Quran authorizes it. They're not purists. They're killers. They're Nazis in headscarves. They aren't leading a religious revival. They're trying to take us back to a state of barbarism that has been extinct for 1,200 years. This is a barbaric revolution, and we have a man in the White House who denies its existence. But whether he chooses to acknowledge it or not, it's going to continue until someone puts a stop to it. Jonathan Sachs called the fight against radical Islam the defining conflict of the next generation. He likened radical Islam to a starfish. When you cut off a spider's head, it dies. But when you cut off the leg of a starfish, the starfish can regenerate it. Radical political Islam is a starfish. If you defeat ISIS or Al-Qaeda, they will merely come back under another name. Why would any government bring in unvetted Muslim immigrants at a time like this? It would seem that only an insane prince would do this to his country. But Obama is not insane. He's stoned. He's stoned on the orthodoxy of the progressive left. Obama and his supporters are drunk on their ideology. They think they're going to create a progressive utopia by continuing their attack on all Western values. This is precisely how great civilizations of the past declined and eventually fell. They rejected the values that made them great and degenerated into narcissism and selfishness. They kept on partying until they were too weak to defend themselves. Then the unthinkable happened. They fell. We've all seen documentary evidence of the Islamo-fascist thugs in ISIS swinging sledgehammers at priceless artifacts they deem offensive to Islam. For 1,000 years, these treasures of antiquity survived wars, earthquakes, and other man-made disasters, but not the current disaster of fundamentalist Islam. As the columns of ancient ruins fall, and the faces of ancient kings and queens are slammed with sledgehammers, we watch in horror, our advanced military technology apparently powerless to stop these Islamic vandals. But it is not our technology or our military that has failed to thwart this destruction of priceless treasures. No. Just as we stand idly by as young girls are kidnapped, raped, and sold into slavery, we are paralyzed not by a lack of technology, but by a lack of will. We have either zero leadership, or a leadership secretly enabling these crimes against humanity. Closer to home, we are similarly paralyzed as this most evil of administrations swings its sledgehammers at our most revered institutions. A climate of fear grips the people as the sneaks in high places spy on us, sell us out to Red China in a secret trade deal, decimate our medical system, eviscerate our military leadership, evaporate our borders, erase our culture, and attack religion's basic tenets. Meanwhile, millions of illegal aliens pour over our southern border, bringing with them an unwillingness to assimilate into American culture, refusing even to speak English. This is what I call Government Zero. We are supposed to be a nation where the government is of the people, by the people, and for the people. Yet every poll shows this rogue government of sneaks and traitors seems to relish doing the opposite of the will of the people. It is a government of itself, by itself, and for itself, run by lobbyists. In short, Government Zero is absolute, unchecked government power and zero representation of the people. It doesn't exist to promote conservative or liberal principles. It is not pro-immigration or anti-immigration. It is not capitalist or socialist. It is not religious or atheist. Those are all just means to its end. Its end is its own preservation and growth. This is by no means a new concept. Most governments throughout history have exploited those they ruled for the benefit of those who controlled them. Before the birth of the American Republic, Government Zero was the rule, not the exception. That was what made the United States a great experiment. When the founders wrote the words, "We the people," they flipped the distribution of power that had existed for thousands of years upside down. They put most of the power in the hands of the people and reserved very little for the government. The government was heavily regulated, and the people were largely free. The government was servant, and the people its master. It was no coincidence that the American people flourished under this scenario. The free society allowed them to pursue their happiness in a largely free market and realize exponential economic and cultural growth. The government served the interests of the people, not because it was good in and of itself, but because it was restrained and ruled by the people. After 100 years of progressive assault, that relationship has reversed. Government has become the master, and the people its servant. The people are restrained, and the government is free to do anything it wants. The government is all-powerful, and the people are powerless. The government is secret, and the people have no privacy. It's a watershed moment in American history, but again, it's nothing new. It's America reverting back to the bondage that has defined most of human history. If that sounds somewhat abstract, I'll bring it home for you. The government can act in its own interests only by acting against yours. It can grow richer only by making you poorer. It can expand its activity only by limiting your freedom. It can ensure its own safety only by threatening yours. That's why the government is attacking everything that makes the world livable for the rest of us. It is attacking free enterprise because it needs higher taxes and more regulation to expand its wealth and power. It is promoting open borders because immigrants from socialist or Islamic countries don't share our traditions of individual liberty and limited government. It wages a war on police because civil unrest allows it to exercise more centralized power or even martial law, eventually with a federal police force answering only to the kings and queens of government. It attacks freedom of speech because dissent is like kryptonite to an all-powerful government. It attacks religion, perverting its very meaning in order to replace what Karl Marx called the opium of the masses with an all-powerful central government becoming the new heroin of the masses. We are well on the road to replacing the former Soviet system with an emerging USSA, the United Soviet States of America. Thomas Paine wrote, "Society in every state is a blessing, but government, even in its best state, is but a necessary evil. In its worst state, an intolerable one. For when we suffer or are exposed to the same miseries by a government which we might expect in a country without government, our calamity is heightened by reflecting that we furnish the means by which we suffer." That couldn't be truer today. When we fund not only the government itself through our taxes, but also the government employee unions, which continue to make the government itself bigger and more oppressive. AFSCME, the largest trade union for public employees in the United States, gave over $65 million to politicians, lobbyists, and activist groups, according to 2014 federal reports obtained by watchdog.org. If your intuition tells you most of this money went to Democratic politicians or left-wing advocacy groups and lobbyists, your intuition is correct. It's just one more way Government Zero feeds itself by draining our economic lifeblood. Out of the frying pan. The good news is this disastrous presidency will finally come to an end in a little over a year. The bad news is we could jump out of the frying pan and into the fire.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.